What did you tell me to finish it up?
In the ISO picture, always in the first place, but the network operator is getting the 2D back. Yeah, the network operator is getting the test signal. So you're always safe. And these are my goals, and definitely some, you know, there are many models of similar kind, which should always be safe. Thanks.
Okay, so
that's
a good question, but if I don't ask them,
and potential in the effective theory we have to introduce fluxes. Now, which flux system you introduced on this orbital and oriental is the most general situation. I will limit my consideration to fluxes of both fields, ignoring the possibility, neglecting here the possibility of the magnetic fluxes localized on this X-ray. So, you can have the Navier-Schwarz fluxes for the 3-4 field set, and there are four components surviving the orbital and oriental projection. You have eight independent fluxes from the Ramon Ramon field strength of different poses. In addition, you can also introduce the so-called geometrical fluxes or metric fluxes that correspond to constant values for suitably anti-symmetrized combinations of spin connection with the internal target spacing. This is nothing else than the fluxes introduced by Schert and Schwarz in the famous paper of 1979. And in this case, you have 12 independent components surviving the orbital and oriental projection. If you want, as we already discussed in other talks at this conference, by repeated application of duality at the level of the effective theory, you may be led to consider also the so-called non-geometrical fluxes that are obtained, for example, from these Schert and Schwarz fluxes, raising one index at a time, applying a duality transformation in one of the directions. I will comment later if there is something on these non-geometrical fluxes. For the moment, I will concentrate on the fluxes, on the geometrical fluxes of the first two lines. So, for the moment, we don't worry about the equations of motion. If our effective theory has been derived correctly with the correct answers for the internal metric, the three-dimensional equation of motion will be reproduced by the four-dimensional equation of motion. Of course, the approximation that we are making doesn't make this statement completely exact. Sorry. But the thing I want to stress is that there are strong constraints on the system of plastic, that is, of five plastics that you can introduce, which derive from the Planck identities that generalize the Gauss law in the compact space. Now, it's the easiest and most reliable way of obtaining the Planck identities in our approach is to derive them from the so-called dual supergravity formulation that was introduced by Berchow, Kalosh, Ortinerus, and Antoy and other years ago in connection with the discussion of the V8 train in the paper. Now, I cannot go into the details of the dual supergravity formulation, but this is the tool that was illustrated at last year's phenomenology conference that we are using to derive our results. Of course, these Planck identities that were already studied previously in the absence of localized sources, and also in other examples, in the literature, can receive contribution from localized sources. In other cases, D6 planes and O6 planes. The integrability conditions of these Planck identities give us powerful consistency constraints that limit the choice of classes that we can introduce. Indeed, these constraints is arrived in a quite general form that we have already derived. For example, if you introduce this generalized derivative operator that as torsion components, the metric fluxes and the free-form flux, then the general expression for the Planck identities in all types of two theories, for example, is this one. This square should be the contribution that is associated to the localized charges of NS train, the short train, and the derivative of the Ramon-Ramon fluxes, which is just the formal sum of all components of the Ramon-Ramon fluxes, should be equal to this expression that contains the localized brain sources and the possible magnetic fluxes. Now, in our example, this formula can be written down very explicitly. You have the non-trivial integrability conditions for our Planck identities are a condition of on the geometrical fluxes, that in fact is a condition that was already derived by Schert and Schwarz many years ago. Then an additional condition that on the right-hand side involves charges associated with V6 planes and O6 planes, and on the left-hand side involves a non-trivial combination of geometrical fluxes, Ramon-Ramon fluxes, and Navier-Schwarz three-form flux. Because of the orbital and oriental projection, all the other conditions in this case are automatically satisfied. Now, once you enforce this condition for the system of classes, you can derive the effective superpotential in the n equal 1 four-dimensional theory, and the effective superpotential as this can be set into this nice geometrical form. This complexified two-form and three-forms, JC and omega C, contain the dependencies in our case on the seven chiral multiplets that we have introduced, and the coefficients in the superpotential are given by the Ramon-Ramon, Navier-Schwarz, and the geometrical classes. This is a generalization of formula that were derived by other authors in different contexts. Now, it's interesting to notice that this formula matches precisely the general formula that you can derive just by a consistent truncation of a gauging of n equal to 4 supergravity. This truncation is telling you that the most general effective superpotential that you can get in this amplitude sector, that is a truncated n equal to 4 sector of your theory, is a degree 7 polynomial in all the set and in different bases, of course, is a degree 7 polynomial in all the 7 moduli fields that we have around, which can be at most of degree 1 in each of the fields. And this formula naturally incorporates also the additional superpotential pieces that are associated to non-geometrical classes. The example is so explicitly that you can check that everything works just by deriving the effective potential by dimensional reduction. If you do this, you find several contributions to the four-dimensional n equal to attention. Here we are concentrating on the Esper part of the domain. You get contributions coming from the 10-dimensional Einstein term, the generalized 10-dimensional kinetic term for the free form, and the generalized 10-dimensional kinetic term for the Ramon force. In addition, you have an important contribution coming from the Dirac interaction associated with the physics brains and also its planes. Now, the effect of the potential is written in terms of flux data only. There is no information on the brains in the coefficient of the superpotential. You can do that precisely because of the generalized identities that are written in the previous transparency that allow you to trade the data associated with these six brains and those explains with the coefficients characterizing classes. And the similar phenomenon occurs, for example, in the Tadu case, as is well known in the Gibbs-Kaprzyk-Wolchinski model and in the Kaprzyk-Wolchinski model. Now, well, with these fluxes, you can, for example, reach stabilization of all moduli without invoking perturbative correction or non-perturbative effect, but I don't have time. This was already discussed last year at the terminology, and I don't have time to repeat that. Let me go to the new material instead. The new material concerns the contributions to the four-dimensional effective potential coming from the U1 fields associated with stats of parallel degrees. I will neglect the gauge fields of the non-abelian part, and I will neglect also the scalar fields coming from excitation leading on brain or a brain intersection. Now, these things are very important, and let me announce what very important role is. First of all, these things will lead to additional Bianchi identities associated with these gauge symmetries, and these additional Bianchi identities will give new constraints.